morning, so I'm going to invite us to an opening prayer this morning. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, having heard your scriptures proclaimed, we pray that you might continue to speak to us this morning, that we might hear the servanthood of your son, Jesus, and be called to live it out in our day-to-day. May the words of my mouth and meditations of my heart be pleasing to you, O Lord, our God. Amen. Well, this morning I thought for a practice, since we are, after all, in summer playlist, and the song that I have chosen for us this morning is one of my favorite songs of all time, I wanted to read scripture, and then I wanted to juxtapose it with the song that we have chosen. So if you're online with us, there hopefully will be a link in Facebook to YouTube, because we can't play it online, but those of us in the sanctuary, I invite you to a prayerful listening of Johnny Cash's Man in Black. Amen. How many of you heard that song before? Yeah? Some of you? Okay, there we go. It is one of my favorite songs, and on like Good Friday, I get to like live out that song, because that's the only day usually where I always wear black, or Ash Wednesday, or liturgical days when I wear black, and we remember suffering and pain in the world. The scripture reading I had for this morning is from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 53, and the passage that I read, or the chapter that I read, is known as the Suffering Servant. And I thought it was appropriate to juxtapose this with the Man in Black song, because if you listen to both the ancient words and the words of Johnny Cash, they have a similar message within it. And sometimes when we hear the songs on the radio and we read scripture, we just think they're so much different than one another, we don't connect the dots between the two. But I think that one of our tasks as Christians in the world is to listen to God speaking in all places, and listen to the voice of God and how God might be speaking through unexpected people, and perhaps even in unexpected places. In 1968, Johnny Cash decided to hold the recording of one of his albums in the most unexpected place of all, at Folsom State Prison. He decided to play it there so he might have them experience the album first and record his albums there. And many of the songs have become songs that we've known for years and years and have heard all over. And he toured all throughout the globe and all throughout the nation, all over the place. But he began in a prison, an unexpected place. And one of the reasons he did so is because he knew a little bit about what life was like to be hard at some point. Grew up in the Depression, lived working out in the cotton or in the fields in Arkansas in hopes that his poor family might inherit or live, be able to own the land that they were working on. And eventually he makes his way into stardom as this musician. But if you know his life a little bit or watched the movie Walk the Line, you know that he finds his way getting into drugs and getting into problems and all sorts of things. And this was a turning point for him that he was trying to change his life around. He had found himself in a clean stent, and he decided to do this album here with people who deserve to listen to this music. And when you hear that story and you listen to his life, it's not a life filled with like roses and, you know, like, I mean, he's got, as a rock star, right? But it's hard. And if you watch the movie Walk the Line, and the movie does a great job depicting Johnny Cash's life and the pain and the challenges that he experiences throughout it. And I think it's partly because he has been there that he's able to sing a song of solidarity with people who suffer throughout the world. He says, I'm the man in black. I would love to wear rainbows every day, but as long as there's people that are suffering, as long as there's the poor, as long as there's the downtrodden, that he is in front to remind all of what? That not everyone is in the state that we find ourselves in. And so you might find yourself here this morning, summer's going great, everything's going well, like you're in a happy place, everything's, you know, good. And that's great. And at the same time, Johnny Cash reminds us, as I'm wearing black today, that not everyone in the world is okay. And I know we can open the news and we can see everything that's going on from throughout our nation, from people in the you know, trajectory of wildfires in California to the atrocities we saw yesterday at the rallies for Donald Trump to all the other things that go on in the world. But here in this space, I would imagine that there is at least someone here or someone watching online that's at a place where it's refreshing to have the reminder that the world is not okay and that there's others that stand with us, the others that stand with us. Isaiah, the prophet, talks about the one who experiences our transgressions, who knows our griefs. And I think one of the challenges that we have is that we skip over to this sort of like the sheep and the slaughter, and we think about Jesus being sacrificed for our sins, because oftentimes this Isaiah chapter 15 is associated with a foreshadowing of Jesus and his life. But I think that one of the things I caution myself over is, I don't know if you remember the movie The Passion of the Christ. Anyone ever see that? Mel Gibson directed it. Well, I was at Azusa Pacific University, a private Christian school, and we were one of the schools that got to do a private screening for this movie because they were trying to test it out with the young Christian young adults throughout the nation. And I got to see it, and we got to talk about it. And one of the phrases that people, I can't believe that Jesus went through this for me. I can't believe that Jesus died for me like this. And at the same time that went out, there's a theologian that I love who I went to Duke to study under, Stanley Hauerwas, and he says, one of the most narcissistic things we can say after watching The Passion of the Christ is, I can't believe he did this for me. Like, this is the reason. That he died for specifically your pain and your suffering, when that's part of it, but it's not the only piece of the puzzle. And I mention that because I think that one of the things that the prophet Isaiah is alluding to in this, and that Jesus does throughout his life, is that there is power not in being for someone, but power in being with someone. Standing in solidarity with someone has its own sort of power. I don't know if you've ever found yourself, you know, even something as trite as like, I'm a Duke basketball fan, just mentioned Duke. And so I'm a Duke basketball fan, and so whenever I see someone walking around in the community with like a Duke hat on or a Duke shirt on, what do? Hey, I like your shirt, right? Because I'm out here in the middle of the Pacific Ocean with not lots of people that are like me, right, Duke fans. That's just a trite understanding, but if you may have found yourself in other circumstances, perhaps you lived or born and raised in Hawaii and you went off to college, mainland, and you go off to college with all these people that have lived mainland, and they do have a different way of living, different, you're just wanting to spam musubi, you can't find it anywhere, and it wasn't until you find this, you know, one other person from Hawaii. Just a few weeks ago, we had the funeral for Cynthia Tom, the mother of one of our longtime members, Deborah Tom, and in hearing the story of Cynthia and Peter, one of the things that stood out to me was that they both found themselves at this camp in like the New England area, and they were the only Chinese people there, so of course, what happened? They connected to one another, and they started dating one another, and then long story short, they were married for 60-plus years together. And it's just the power in finding someone like you. That when you find someone like you, you connect and you resonate, and all of a sudden you don't feel alone. That the most powerful thing that Jesus does in this world, I believe most firmly, is that Jesus doesn't come to fix our world's problems, unfortunately. But what Jesus does is even harder, which is to take on the pain, to take on the grief, to take on the suffering, to become Isaiah's suffering servant, and choose to be with us. So no matter where we go, we can have this phrase, this belief that we have, that God is with us, always. And so if we feel alone, or we feel like there is no one else who understands our pain, our grief, our challenges, the things that we're facing at home and at work, we know that God has chosen not to fix our situation, but God has chosen to be with us, to be with us always. One of the things that you learn about in divinity school is not the plumbing situation that we had to deal with over the past week, which was fixed and resolved and we're taken care of now, but we learn about like other different denominations and what they believe and the theologies around what they believe and why they believe it. And one of the things that I remember learning about, and it stuck with me, is learning about the difference between Protestant churches and Roman Catholic churches and how they have the symbol of the cross is different, right? Because in Protestant churches, the symbol of the cross is the cross. In Roman Catholic churches and Orthodox churches, the cross is never just the cross. It's what? The crucifix. So I know some of our Catholics in the room, it chimed into that. It's the crucifix, that Jesus is on the cross. And we get in this debate along, you know, well, Jesus is no longer on the cross, Jesus raised from the dead, you know, he's all these things. And then, you know, the Roman Catholics will have their answers, which may or may not align with the theology that I learned. But I read this theologian, Jürgen Moltmann, who talks about Jesus as being forevermore the suffering one. That Jesus is forevermore the suffering one because Jesus chose to believe or to live out this life of being with us always. And so that wherever there is suffering in the world, that Jesus is still there with us. He's with us in the joys, but he is there in the painful times. And so the idea that Jesus on the cross for a crucifix, they would say, is the reminder that there is still suffering in the world. So when we see the cross and we see Jesus suffering, we're reminded that Jesus is with those people always. And it's easy when life is good to forget about those who are just nearby us, who are challenged and going through difficult circumstances. And that's one of the things I love about this song, because Johnny Cash wasn't just a person that, you know, talked about things being good, but he lived it out in his life. He had this Folsom Prison album in the prison because he knew that there were people in there that were suffering, that have repented for what they had done wrong in their life, and simply there, they've made all sorts of life changes. But he wanted to let them know that there's people rock star of all things, country star of all things, that remembers them and that's willing to be there with them. And the irony of, I think, all of this for me is that sometimes people have this impression of church being the place where we have our lives together, right? Or, you know, I'm the best dad because I'm a pastor, or, you know, if you've been in church and involved in church, you never make any mistakes, or, you know, people, they put us up on pedestals, like, you know, we're judging the world around us, or we think that we're better, or maybe none of those things, that we just are better people. But all of us know, if I just took a minute to be introspective for a second, it won't take very long for us to remember our flaws and to remember the wrongs that we've done. And sometimes we try to push them to the side. But I think that remembering our confession and remembering our brokenness helps create a space for others who are also broken to feel at home with us. One of the things my wife, Ashley, does way better than me is she can talk to someone for about a minute and know their life story. Really, like we'd be joking, we're like, where's mom? The kids are inside and we're about to do dinner. Like, she's talking to someone on the street. And it's like, she goes out, she's just on the street hanging out, wanting to get the mail, and she knows their life stories. And she's able to resonate with people, not because she's, you know, is better than them, but because she shares her own vulnerability within the context of a story, and it just draws it out of people. Johnny Cash is the least perfect person. If you know his life story, you know, while, yes, admirable, he went to Folsom Prison and he decided to get clean. But after that, he was, you know, in this relationship with June, and over again, June's trying to throw away the pills and the drugs just to try to keep him on the right track. And over again, he's reminded that he too is a suffering one. And as he sang this song to remind people that others are with them, he was transparent. Others knew that he was with them, that he had his own sort of suffering. And I think that, friends, this is the power of the church. A number of years back, I gave a Christmas Eve sermon, The Power of God With, Not God For. You know, sometimes people are like me, and we like to fix the world around us. I'm a fixer. Get it done. Make it happen. But on Christmas, we remember that God doesn't choose to fix, but God chooses to be with. God finds God's self on the cross to suffer on our behalf, yes, and most importantly, to suffer with us. And so, friends, this is the role of the church, to be a place where others feel they have someone to be with during their hard times, to be available, to listen, to be a non-judgmental presence in their lives, to remember the sick, to remember those in prison, to remember those who don't have the luxuries that perhaps we're experiencing now. That's the power of us, the church, living out this man in black mentality together. And sure, we can have sunny days and we can have joyful days. But we also remember always that there's those who don't. Professor once shared with me, why do we stand and why do we sit? Why do we say things together in a worship service? Why do we pray confessions together? And he said, well, you may not feel like it in the moment, but there's power of doing it together alone, that we're standing together, that we're praying together, that we're singing together, because it reminds us of that fundamental faith that God is with us. And every single Sunday when we gather, we have the prayers of the people, and one of the always in the prayers, while I might mention joys, I always remind us of what? The world around us. That even though things are going great in our lives, that together we remember the pain of the world, because Jesus is there with those people. And it's in those places of suffering that there's hope, because God is with us always and will never abandon us and will never leave us. And those of us who have experienced that in our lives know the deep, abiding faith and hope that comes from just knowing that someone is here with me in the hard times. I invite you to pray with me. God of love, we give thanks that in the power and wisdom of your love, you chose to leave the glories of your throne room, whatever that may look like, and humble yourself, not only to walk upon this earth, but to go to the unexpected places, to meet with the lowly people, fishermen and tax collectors and sinners, lepers, those in need of healing, ostracized from communities. And it's there where you make your presence known. And then in your final days, rather than overthrowing the kingdom of Rome, which was the expectation of the Messiah, you chose instead to suffer with all of the world upon the cross. And so as we read the news, as we hear the stories of our friends, as we go through hardship ourselves, let us remember that you, O God, are always the one in black. You are always the one who stands with us, no matter how dark the nights get. So help us remember that we are called to do the same. Amen.